Philosophers have often pondered the question, does a tree falling in a forest make a sound if nobody is around to hear it? Nobody has ever bothered to be around when 1,000 trees were falling on Ernst Zündel's life to test that theory. They came in broad daylight, in full regalia, with shining brass buttons, boots cleanly polished. They came with handcuffs and leg irons made by a U.S. subsidiary in Mexico.
They came for Ernst Zündel in America. There was no warning. There was no arrest warrant. He was frisked and handcuffed just like a common criminal and whisked away to a Blount County jail in our neighborhood. It took only a few minutes. Here's what I want to know. Why do his enemies fear Ernst so much to go to such extraordinary length to silence him?
Meet one of the world's best-known political activists for civil rights for Germans, Ernst Zündel. Ernst Zündel's political outreach will not be told here. It is extensively documented on the internet. Let us simply ask, who is this man? What did he do that caused him to be incarcerated for 7 years in various prisons in so-called democratic countries? A modern prisoner of conscience, Ernst Zündel dared to challenge entrenched political power in several Western states, beholden to an alien mindset of history fabricated for profit, including post-war Germany, where speaking the truth is now a crime enshrined in law. Perhaps it was believed that 6 prisons in 3 countries on 2 continents would silence this intrepid German. Not so. 1,000 will be hacking at the branches to 1 who is striking at the root.
My real crime is that I wanted to remain a German in a thoroughly anti-German age. My ordeal would have been over a long time ago, if only I would apologize for seeking historical truth and prostrate myself before my detractors. I could have ended my troubles by simply recanting with 1 letter or 1 phone call to my tormentors. My tenacity, my unbending pursuit for the rehabilitation of my German people was going to be punished by those who won World War II.
People who have been through war, as Ernst and I experienced it in our childhood, are collectors. No throwaway society for us. Things have to be saved and preserved, including truthful history.
A high-profile activist, best known for having initiated the first ever forensic investigations of Auschwitz and other Third Reich concentration camps, Ernst Zündel challenged the central taboo of our time. As a German descendant, Ernst Zündel refused to live on his knees. This is one of the world's most extraordinary stories, one of willpower over fate. They said he was a hateful man, but let us check the evidence. Insisting on a balanced view of history is not spreading hatred. Most people would call that free speech. Falsely imprisoned for speaking the truth against power, Ernst Zündel was fighting against an invisible foe behind which stand the world's wealthiest people and its most powerful political lobbies.
This happened in the wake of the U.S. Patriot Act. Ernst was swept up by 5 agents of the U.S. government acting as hit squads in the employ of a nefarious lobby. In broad daylight, right in front of our door. His first prison sketches originated there.
Valentine's Day was approaching in less than a week. I wanted to cheer Ingrid up with a Valentine's Day card. I saw an American inmate paint a wolf's face in pen and ink, with a wobbly plastic tube ballpoint pen. He was a big 220-pound bruiser, always hungry, as were most of the inmates who were forced to fill up on junk food, chips and MSMs, chocolate, nut bars and the like, if they had the funds to buy it in the prison store. I approached him with a proposal. I would give him my pancakes plus jam and toast if he would rent me his ballpoint pen for 1 hour and let me have one sheet of his small supply of paper. True to my reputation as a frugal Schwabian, I tore the 8.5 by 11 inches sheet in half so I could have another piece for later use. I made Ingrid a nice Valentine's Day card. It took 27 days from the day that I mailed it in Blount County Jail to reach our home, maybe 35 miles away.
The other prisoners crowded around Ernst Zündel outside his cell in what was called the range, where sturdy metal tables and benches were bolted to the cement floor. The Zündel Prison Art Studio was born then and there.
A big black fellow, a truck driver, pushed his way through the crowd of prisoners who had gathered around me. He wanted a card for his girlfriend too. I asked for the name and personalized it for her by adding hearts and kisses. He rendered me a precious book he had in his cell, titled American National Parks. He told me I could have it for 3 days. We formally shook hands on the deal. From this book came the inspiration for a number of sketches of national parks, old homesteads, gnarly old trees, fences, barns, which I quickly drew and sent off to Ingrid.
As soon as the inmates saw that Ernst could draw, they pressed closer, and serious bargaining took place around the Zündel table.
Another man gave me 3 sheets of paper for some apple pie, oversweetened as all this stuff was in America. I did not miss it. One young white fellow facing over 20 years for drug dealing was willing to trade me the use of his ballpoint pen if I made him a letter-sized drawing of his vintage Camaro, of which he showed me a faded color Polaroid cut off at the end. That boy had tears in his eyes. That photo was his most prized possession. He wanted to know if I could reproduce that vehicle replete with an imaginary rear end. I drew the young man's car and business started booming. Unfortunately, my free enterprise barter system was short-circuited by my being expelled from America to Canada without ever having been inside a US courtroom or in front of a US judge. Meet the threatening revisionist. You can see me in this one portrait as a scarecrow in a grain field, with blue jeans and checkered red and white farmer's shirt, clothes I wore when I was arrested. Even though this sketch has a large Star of David in the sky above it, the censor closed his eyes.
He was thrown into a hellhole of a prison while the government of Canada dreamt up a charge that he was a national security risk, in other words, a terrorist. After 2 years in brutal solitary confinement, he was flown to Germany, accompanied by 7 Canadian government officials in a chartered plane at taxpayers' expense, because in Germany it is against the law to contradict the Jewish version of precisely what happened during World War II in places such as Auschwitz. This documentary will introduce Ernst Zündel as you have never been allowed before to see this complex, versatile, responsible, and thoughtful activist for truth in history. Ingrid was not to be reunited permanently with her husband for 10 years. In this documentary produced by her, she strives to make the Zündel message stand out in relief and be heard. During the only 15-minute visit behind bulletproof glass permitted to Ingrid while Ernst was still in custody in the US, She had told him of a local carpenter who had helped him with his gallery building.
He was one of our Tennessee neighbors who dropped in to offer Ingrid his support after my arrest. I had given him a 2x4-inch pine wood block left over from our building construction, on which I had painted a Tennessee mountain scene to use up my last dabs of color. He told Ingrid that on the internet he had mentioned that he knew me personally, and such was the pull of my name that the U.S. dentist offered him $1,000 within minutes, sight unseen, for that small piece of wood a little larger than a bar of soap. When Ingrid told me this story, I knew we had found a medium, a way for me to continue to be helpful to her from behind prison bars. U.S. philosopher Francis Parker Yawkey says, "Power goes to him who seeks it," and my political opponents are seeking global power, whereas we Gentiles merely seek a life free of their influence and control. Court cases, therefore, are really a form of warfare by other means, where those in the corridors of power can help themselves from the taxpayer's trough, while dissidents are forced to pay for their own defense while being shouted down by an obliging media.
Lawyers for dissidents do not come cheap, believe me. I had these very simple prison sketches. I made hundreds of copies and I sent them as tokens of appreciation to supporters from all over the world who rallied to our side with donations to pay off our bills.
I drew a picture of a grist mill from memory, as I had seen it in Cates Cove Park, not very far from our home, and our beautiful summer vista overlooking parts of the Great Smoky Mountains. Ingrid gave those first sketches as numbered prints to our better donors. That's how the first desperately needed money was raised for my defense, for the lawyers gobble up money at an alarming rate, let me tell you.
Over the next 7 years of his imprisonment, Ernst made many thousands of these little sketches and thank you notes of every kind, often with primitive tools, poor colors, amateur pencils, and schoolchildren's crayons. He sent them to Ingrid, to friends, to supporters, to strangers. These sketches were like little envoys of goodwill.
Since my arrest and incarceration, the traffic on the Zündel site increased dramatically and now hovered between 1 million and 1.2 million visitors per month. These visitors, in turn, access 2.4 documents per visit. No wonder the Canadian government and the German governments hated everything about Ernst Zündel, his courageous wife, and his worldwide set of followers who made his global information outreach possible. I am in prison because of that website. That is why I refer to myself as the world's first internet website hostage, and I am seriously thinking that rather than fighting with lawyers in court, I should engage a hostage negotiator. There is little life still left in my last pencil stub.
Later, quite a few sketches were drawn in court after his transfer to Canada using attorneys Doug Christie's and Peter Lindsay's pens, while the legal arguments around him droned on. Animals, birds, butterflies were innocent decorations that the censors allowed out of prison in the mail. He sketched fall and winter scenes, raccoons, gophers, rabbits and field mice. He sketched grasses of all kinds, delicate, pretty, Christmas and other holiday motifs, and roses for Valentine's cards.
You ask me why I draw so many different snowbells. Snowbells were the sacred flower of the ancient Celtic and Germanic tribes. They were the first signs of life and beauty after the long period of ice, snow, and dark wintry nights. Our ancestors were deeply worshipful people, respecting nature and living in awe and submission to its rules. For me, there was also a practical reason. I had only access to cheap paper in writing pads, and lots of color would have made the paper curl. detailed landscapes would simply have eaten up too much of my precious paint and colors. That's also the reason for the absence of blue skies and golden sunsets or saturated green fields of grass. Snowbells needed very, very little paint, stretching my available colors much more than more would involve in other motives. Only green stems and a few pointed stylized leaves, and presto, I could stretch my paint 10 and 20 fold. The same for pussy willows, even poppies. I must have sketched thousands of them. A splash of red, a thin stem, a leaf or two, and I had created something happy and cheerful, which had the benefit of passing the censors without any problems for me. And why the barbed wire with the little drops of blood? That's my prison moniker. I was announcing to the world, these pieces were done not in the Soviet Union or Communist China's gulag, but behind barbed wire in prisons in various so-called Western democracies, where speaking the truth is now a crime.
Have a nice Christmas, Ingrid, and a happy and healthy New Year. We owe it to our friends and to our many supporters. This is, of course, more than a Christmas card. This is a declaration of resolve that as this season passes with its family obligations, its introspection, and blending back to Christmas's past, we will, like nature after solstice, look forward to a new awakening, a new spring, new life, and new initiatives inside and outside of prisons, courtrooms, and detention centers. Ernst sketched eagles, the heraldic symbol of many Western nations, notably America, Germany, Prussia, Poland, even Albania, as well as some Baltic countries.
I love drawing eagles. Eagles in flight, eagles at rest on tree branches, or eagles perching on rocks, clutching prey. The sight of an eagle seems always uplifting. It signifies an ancient bond among brother nations, a good starter for some interesting conversations with American tourists who, so we had hoped, would come to our gallery and bookshop where we plan to display my paintings as well as Ingrid's books. Ingrid and I were married by then. We lived and worked in harmony. I was happy at her side. Together we developed a forward-looking program that astonished friends who visited us. We had such gentle plans. That is why I retreated to the mountains of beautiful, peaceful Tennessee to rest and to reflect, to rethink from scratch what, if anything, could be done to stop and hopefully reverse the decline of our race to oblivion. All my waking hours, as I dug over my garden, planted my flowers, and tended to my potatoes, were devoted to the Herculean problem of how best to do what needs to be done if we want to assure the survival of our children and grandchildren and our culture in the years and decades ahead. I care about my people. I care about what was unjustly said about and done to Germany. Therefore, I was determined to do battle in the courtrooms on both sides of the Atlantic. I knew I could help Ingrid to raise the money for the coming legal struggle. I knew that Ingrid would be faced once again with very expensive lawyer's bills. How much would only reveal itself in the 7 years to come. We are facing a global power grab by criminally insane people. For us, it is a change or die scenario. It is death in installments, suicide by alien invasion. It seems as if the poison against the Gentile mind has almost completed the job. The collective Western psyche seems fully infected by the obfuscation and lies of its enemies. No doctor can cure measles by scraping away one red spot at a time. Only history is the final court of appeal in distant time and possibly a fairer, less poisonous age. There is also my very deep knowledge that I was put on this earth with a role to fulfill. I am conscious of my place in history and also conscious and alert to the fact that this may well be the last time that while still in Canada, I will be tried in a traditional Anglo-Saxon courtroom. Germany is totally controlled by a politicized judiciary system. No transcripts in many cases, no expert witnesses, no exonerating documents will ever be allowed there once I get deported to the country of my birth. These court transcripts are my signature beneath the story of my life. The reality is, we Germans are tired of being kicked around, vilified, portrayed as Colonel Klinks, and often far worse, as war criminals and murderers. We too are people with feelings. We too have hearts, minds, and souls. I have always acted within the laws of where I lived, in accordance with the dictates of my conscience and by listening to my own inner directives. At all times and with the greatest of care, I strove to speak the truth about my people of the World War II generation, explaining to the world the intent and governmental strategic ideas of a long bygone era. Do I think this is the end of me? Not at all. Only my physical death would more or less accomplish that, and probably not even then. Regime change is in the air. The world of our enemies is coming unhinged. Their nefarious schemes are being revealed for all they were from the beginning. Half-truths, untruths, conspiracies, deceptions, lies, evil schemes. At the beginning of a new millennium, the spirit that dominates our planet is alien.
In general, because of tight and ruthless censorship, political topics were off limits. Many of the more explicit Zündel sketches never made it to the outside world. Some blockade breakers did get through, however. For instance, the Peace Tower of Parliament Hill in Ottawa, Canada, featured him in his famous blue parka and blue helmet. Other political sketches simply vanished in the mail. Ernst's interrupted life with Ingrid in Tennessee's Wares Valley was a recurring theme in many of his letters from prison.
How I wish I could be with you, surrounded by all this beauty. Wares Valley in the fall with all those pastel-y hues of color I used to marvel at, instead of being in this cold, all steel and concrete cell. One more reason, apart from not being at your side, to miss what we were building. You might see blue-stemmed lilies because the green pencils simply wear out too quickly and they break so easily that I simply have to send you once in a while fantasy flowers to use up some of the other colors in my assortment. My 2.5 years with you in the peaceful surroundings of those quiet hills and dales, the fantastic greens of spring, and the riot and blaze of colors in the fall, our bench, our walks, our talks, our quiet meals, our work. That was the life I had been longing for. Our dreams and visions, all those magnificent plans will come to fruition one day, I guarantee it. All things need their time, almost like a gestation period after conception. Time to develop until a thought or a vision gets born. To rush it would amount to a risky premature birth or even a tragic abortion. This helps me sustain my equilibrium in solitary confinement to know that cosmically a birth will take place after conception has occurred. Will you and I be present at the birth? I don't know, for I am not God, only Ernst, your husband, partner, and friend. So keep the dream, nurture it. Let us always divest each day some of our energy and any money we can spare, even if it's only a postage stamp for one more sketch, one more letter to reach out to touch someone to make a dream help come true. When it comes to religion, I've always been very tolerant because I agree with the tenet that religion is one of the most private and intimate parts of a person's life. Being incarcerated has given me lots of time to study, to reflect, which I did not have for many years before. So that is a benefit to me. Seriously, the amount I have been able to learn from those government documents is amazing. Finally, having the time to cross-reference things has clarified many things for me in my mind. I'll be twice as smart by the time I get back out. Then I will be unbearable. My belief in reincarnation and karma, for instance, are a total control mechanism on all I do, say, and write. I believe in my heart that I am totally innocent of all these accusations. The nasty stuff in the press is pure character assassination, and I will leave it to the cosmic cops to look after those who torment me. I believe that all those who have hounded me so mercilessly for so long will receive their just punishment. Not by me. I do not have the hate or thirst for vengeance they seem to be consumed by. I simply do not have it in me to be like that. I sit on my stacked Holocaust-related court transcripts and seven fat Sherlock's-bound volumes, 1,806 pages of accusations against me, all newspaper articles from Canada, the USA, and Europe on what others said, wrote, and did. Only three tabs out of 129 are items by me. One is one page long, the other 1 to 4 pages, out of millions of words written and spoken by me in my career, a total of three tabs. This is the pitiful essence of their case, plus, of course, secret evidence by secret witnesses heard in camera behind locked doors, which only the judge and the government lawyers present. My own attorneys and I do not know a word of what was presented and claimed, who these people are. As the Canadian laws now stand, I will never know. They have my body caged up here for the moment, but my spirit soars free. That's why I prophetically wanted our gallery to be called Soaring Eagles Gallery. Other eagles will be drawn to our cause to soar with us, leaving the turkeys behind on the ground. I believe in an unobstructed universe. The sky is not the limit. My defense of wartime Germany and its leaders is not an act of stubbornness, of self-immolation. It is based on an unwritten contract between them and succeeding generations. It is organic, and it is a duty incurred by my generation. Only death itself can release me of this cosmic obligation.
Ernst and Ingrid had gone flat out financially to purchase and finish a very attractive little house with excellent access to one of Tennessee's most traveled roads. They had passed all building inspection hurdles, the carpets were in, Ernst's sister had sewn lacy curtains. The place looked nice and inviting.
If after having been informed, the people of the world chose stupidly to continue kneeling before a taboo, a cult of death, well, let them. Our task was to pay homage to life, to strive for the light of the universe. Not that we would abandon what had been accomplished, but henceforth it would be the backdrop to where our focus would be and the platform on which we would stand.
The Zündel name carried impact globally. Ernst was proud of himself, proud of his supporters, who had played a crucial part in having helped checkmate historical lies and harmful distortions. He felt that others could do the mopping up, that he could rest his battered psyche and rebuild his damaged health. Now he could meditate, think, evaluate what he had done right, where maybe the movement went wrong, and set new goals to reach the stars, for there was a universe still to be conquered, or a planet to be lost to ignorance and greed, literally.
Of course, I longed to hand our people back their pride and lift the burden of induced guilt from their lives. Much closer to my inner yearning, I also longed to move into more vital and intriguing fields of improvement of human behavior through the radical change of the human diet. For we are what we eat, and we can't be what nature has decided we should be if we fail to consume what we need. In our beautiful mountains of Tennessee, our Western culture's finest minds would blaze new trails for our people. We dreamt of genuinely cosmic inquiries, not to poke around Europe's ruins and dusty archives, being satisfied with spending a short lifetime by being the proverbial bean counters of how many Jews, Gypsies, Germans, and Russians died, how, when, where, and why. How often do you redig an archaeological site to discover yet one more bone, yet one more shard? We wanted to enhance and energize the welfare of the living, and the survival and the golden future of generations yet unborn. There was so much to be learned, so much to be applied. That was the dream. It still is. The as yet not realized vision of what Ingrid and I try to start, using the talents and pooled resources of our loyal and faithful Zündel supporters. We still intend to press ahead, quietly, steadily, one step and one dime at a time. We will kickstart the counter-revolution right in the quiet hills of Tennessee, starting with art and with music. For instance, what I am looking for is music to span the generations.
Ernst and I saw ourselves as being able to provide the nucleus of such facilities, to allow people who are akin to our way of thinking and feeling to come together for quiet but intensive interchanges of ideas, thoughts, and concepts, far away from the noise and clamor of the world, in serene and constructive contemplation, connecting in friendship to similar people and outlook. It was our hope to have these conclaves without fanfare, made possible by the donations of our supporters, many of whom had already visited us and shared with us in our dreams.
Behind bars, reality often intruded, time-consuming bureaucratic nightmares to get a few extra replacement papers, for instance, on which he could draw. Often it was simply dumpster diving, checking the garbage can next to the showers. His early prison artwork reflects the severe restrictions he was under for most of his 7 years of imprisonment, inside 6 prisons in 3 countries on 2 continents. Another problem throughout much of Ernst's incarceration was lack of reference material. It was really hard to come by. He had no books, no newspapers. His mail was severely censored. There was no library in either of the Canadian prisons where he was kept in solitary confinement. Therefore, much of what he drew was from memory, some even from his childhood. Goats, sheep, roosters, wheat stalks, roses, marguerites, pansies, butterflies, anything innocent enough the censors could not hold back. In the following letter, Ernst told Ingrid what happened when the great pencil sharpener disaster struck.
Now, who in the real world out there in freedom would ever think a crisis would be caused by a broken pencil sharpener at the beginning of the 21st century? Besides, who still uses pencils anyway? Picture a young, nice, very polite female guard, always willing to undertake the long walk to that mysterious place where that, for me, enormously important invention of the year 1880 is kept, the pencil sharpener of a modern Canadian prison. She first has to open my feeding slot with an old brass key for a noisy lock in my thick metal cell door, and with a Bambi-like move and look of her pretty eyes just visible to me as she bends down to talk to me through my feeding slot, she tells me, "Sorry, Zündel, the pencil sharpener is not working." She hands me my pitiful fistful of pencils, some colored art pencils made in China, with utterly inferior, constantly breaking tips. I am on my knees so I can talk through the slot to be heard over the prison noise on the other side. But she is called away by another inmate's furious pounding on a cell door down the hall. She flips the thick metal door covering my feeding slot with such a loud steel-on-steel bang that every steel plate wall of my cell bounces the echo around. Reality begins to sink in as I take a troubled inventory of my totally, partially, and not yet dull pencils and pencil stubs. I look at my pile of papers in my cell, looking every day more like my legendary messy desk in Tennessee or earlier in Toronto, as I begin to prioritize. Who will get a letter with the remaining supply of pencils, and who will have to wait? Which letters don't I have to make painstaking handwritten copies of? Which ones can I risk sending out without copies? Weekends are not a good time to get serious repairs done in jail or anywhere else. For the next 3 days, every guard, male or female, old or young, at every feeding time, shower or exercise walk in the prison yard is asked, begged, pleaded with, "How about that pencil sharpener situation? Fixed yet?" "Nope." "Any chance for a new one?" "They are working on it." I sweeten the offer. "I'll pay for it. I have money in my account. I'll buy it for you, and you'll lend it to me. I'll sharpen my pencils and immediately give it back to you." Consternation. "We can't do that." I commiserate via telephone with Ingrid, my lady lawyer, my lead attorney in 5,000 kilometers distant Victoria, BC, my university professor, son Pierre. He tells his wife of the great crisis in his father's life.
She dreams about airlifting a gross of pencil sharpeners to her children's grandfather in distant Toronto so that the little ones can get their frequent missives from Opa Ernst. She tells him about that strategy, and though starved for sharp pencils, he has to beseech her not to cause him grief with the prison administration with that pencil sharpener airlift. They might take it as an affront from their troublesome houseguest with all that legal mail pouring into the prison center's already overworked office. Ernst reluctantly puts an already dull pencil to paper and fills out an SOS request form. He signs it, dates it. He adds the hour of his request, guessing because he sees no daylight. He has no idea what time it is. He shoves the request form through the crack under his cell door.
The prison quiets down. The lights are dimmed just for the night a little bit. I think of Ingrid all alone in Tennessee as I drift off to sleep on my hard prison cot. Morning comes. The crack in the feeding slot opens. A food tray is shoved in. I spot a native Indian female guard and decide she is the motherly, middle-aged type. I can ask her about the pencil sharpener situation. Boy, am I wrong in my pick. She could not care less and stomps on. I sit uncomfortably crouched in my Spartan prison bed and wonder in utter amazement how, under the circumstances, anything actually works in this prison. These people come in, punch the clock, drink coffee, hold other people hostage with asinine conversations, go to lunch, shuffle some papers, punch the clock, ask what's for supper, eat, have sex, go to sleep, get up and steal another day from the good Lord's time. We cannot, no, we dare not, and must not under any circumstances continue our present course of merely reacting to the constant attacks in every sphere of life by our sworn enemies. We have been on the defensive culturally, politically, and philosophically since Karl Marx wrote Das Kapital, which Bismarck checked briefly by adopting or stealing some of Marx's socialist ideas. Western culture as an organism failed to come up with an antidote to Marx's dialectical materialism. No functional method, no ism like syndicalism or socialism could stop Marxist ideology from poisoning European minds and hearts.
What they called the exercise yard in Toronto West was really a cage made of concrete walls and a barbed wire ceiling, in size about that of an average room. Whenever it suited the guards, which wasn't all that often, Ernst would be allowed to do a few rounds.
One day I spotted this tender shoot of grass growing in between the brick wall and the concrete floor of the prison. For weeks I quietly watched this tiny harm strive for the light. When it looked nice and mature, I asked the security chief of the prison, Mr. Bertrand, if I could take it to my cell to sketch it. No, was the harsh answer. The next day I looked for my little speck of life here in the prison yard. Somebody had torn it out by the roots and thrown it aside. It lay there, in the heat, all limb and lifeless, becoming hay, symbolic evidence of how deeply I was hated by so many. What unmitigated evil stalks this planet!
Ernst spent 2 winters in that inhuman Canadian prison. It was horribly cold. A kind guard once gave him an extra T-shirt. Another guard took it away. His attorney, Doug Christie, promised he would one more time raise with the prison officials and the judge the issues of no pillows, no sheets, no highlighter, pens, post-it notes, also no chair, and only infrequent fresh air allotments. Meanwhile, Ernst put some of his court transcripts underneath the mattress for a little elevation for his head.
Doug calls me back and says the judge wants written submissions on the pillow situation. Imagine our judge, a former Canadian cabinet minister, having to get together with Canada's highest Nazi war crimes prosecutor to get your husband a pillow after months and months in prison. Those padded sheets, called suicide sheets, made of Kevlar I have been sleeping on, have not been changed in 3 months and 10 days. They do better in Tajikistan or Outer Slobovia. I complain to the prison authorities. I again complain to my lawyer. He complains to the judges and the Attorney General of Ontario. And finally, we got some action going. Revenge. By 3 o'clock, the hall outside my cell is abuzz with activity. Captains, guards, lots of guards are milling about. Several barge into my cell, order me out into the hall, and tell me, we are going to get you a pillow, some sheets, more regular fresh air, showers, but we are going to search your stuff and take out a few things. All my papers, all my files were dumped on the cell bed and even on the floor along with my already sorted pencils. Even my styrofoam cups in which I mix my Lorraine Day liquid diet, 12 cups of very thinned down apple or orange juice to flavor the fluoridated liquid, which I have a real problem drinking down each day. Dr. Day had said to me on the phone that this would help me get my blood pressure down naturally by thinning my blood.
The prison captain told Ernst sternly that it was against regulations to self-medicate. He was a hazard to himself. Only treatments prescribed by the prison doctor and medical staff were allowed to inmates. Out into the garbage went all his carefully saved styrofoam cups, along with spare juice containers he used to mix up his magic potion for the evening. Everything went either down the drain or into the garbage. He had made himself some cardboard writing surfaces on his steel table. Into the garbage they went. all his pencils too, which he kept organized in little plastic cups in which he got pudding or apple sauce. He had washed these out, dried them, and sorted his sparse writing and sketching tools according to color and kind.
Soft pencils were in one container, those horrible hard prison pencil in another. A third container held the dull ones. Now the guards were told to tip all of them in a pile on the table. I was told by the captain that he was only going to permit me a very limited number, because according to him, these pencil stubs, many of them no more than 2.5 to 3.5 inches long, presented a safety hazard to the staff. So there you have it. I had to give up my water diet, most of my pencils, most of my correspondence, and many documents and books, some of which you so kindly sent me. I want history one day to record the lunacy of all this. Imagine, my sweetheart, your husband being reduced to having to explain to you all this trivial stuff while civilization hangs at the brink of collapse. I actually am so lost in the quiet of my room, my cell that is, that I pretend I am a monk in one of those medieval European monasteries. I'm not joking or making light of things, nor am I trying to put a good face on a dismal situation. I can get so engrossed in my studies or my writing and drawing that I am at times completely oblivious to my surroundings. Only my orange jumpsuit tells me that I am, in fact, a prisoner in maximum security, rather than Martin Luther in the Wartburg, chiseling away at his 95-point thesis, his declaration of independence against the crippling of the mind. I feel utterly at peace with myself, more so than I have at any time outside that I can recall. Inside my heart and my soul, I am calm, not resigned. I don't feel resigned. I am accepting these conditions as temporary turbulence on the flight path of my life. I have succeeded in large measure through friends like you, more than I ever dared to dream possible. I am combative as always, but eerily calm, like a man who instinctively perceives that something big, mysterious, not yet completed, is being worked out in the cosmos. I await the results, matter-of-factly, whatever they may be. You might say that I am a man who has conquered his last fears. Last night I had an odd but very vivid dream. You and I had made true to our promise to each other and went on a cruise to Singapore of all places. Why there? I have not the faintest idea. The monstrously large cruise ship, gleamingly white, docked in the harbor, and we were in berth or cabin 89. Odd that I remember that. Not 88, 89. We were all dressed up, you in a very nice swooshy floral patterned dress and high heels, and I in a white linen suit, slim, believe it or not. We strolled along the decks, looking up at the moonlit sky. The air was balmy, Hawaii-like, the way I remember it from my previous trips to Singapore and Hawaii. It was as real as can be in a dream. I'll obviously have to continue that dream tonight or pick another destination. Is this not odd? I have no books or magazines to kickstart such a dream. Where in the recesses of my mind and imagination did I drag up all those millions of pixels to assemble a magnificent cruise ship? A band, bar, dance floor. I mean, it was one elaborate production, let me tell you. Anyway, since I am the guy with a vivid imagination, I thought I'd let you in on my dreams. I have already been reassigned to a cell with a window where I can see blue sky and the sun. I have finally been allowed to keep all my court documents in my cell. For the first time in almost 4 months, there is a corner table and a shelf for my books and transcripts. Now I can see the sky, and this morning a stab of sunlight is falling on my table and the papers on it, and is reflected on the floor. I spent 3 months in Thorold Prison in Ontario in a windowless cell, not knowing when it was day or night, often not knowing what day of the week it was. I am allowed access to the phone outside the hall. True, it wastes the time of two guards and an officer who have more important work to do than listening to me telling my wife that I love her and miss her and that I would rather be in Tennessee painting than in solitary confinement in Toronto. These high-powered men, executive officer types, sit there patiently while Canada's most reviled man sharpens his 15 pencil in the guardroom. Sometimes it is difficult for me to distinguish reality, visions, and dreams. After all, is there a difference? Take Stonehenge. I had toured Stonehenge in the 1960s and 1970s. I nostalgically recall how I stood all alone in that mist, the rising fogs, for hours, it seemed, one morning. I had Stonehenge all to myself for a glorious 12 hours. I filmed some of it, but most tapes were lost in the 1995 Zündel House arson my enemies saw fit to inflict. They even admitted to it to the press. My wallpaper discovery. For the record, here is what happened. I was dumpster diving, as it were, always hunting for a little scrap of extra paper. And I came across this huge 3-foot by 3-foot old American wallpaper catalog. No kidding. I have no idea how it ended up in the German prison of all places. Ingrid, I could not believe my luck. I pointed out to the crafts instructor in charge the lovely textures I could paint on. And again, the rest is history. Thousands of bookmarks and postcards are testimony that one can really make silk purses out of sow's ears. Some of my nicest creations resulted because the gods made sure that I would spot that precious wallpaper catalog.
One day, Ernst truly hit the jackpot. He had befriended a prisoner, a lifer, who gave him a very small amount of India ink, along with a fine steel nib. Prisoners were not to have this ink because it could be used to make tattoos. This prisoner had been allowed this ink decades ago when guards were not yet so paranoid. Ernst treated those two little items like Midas fingering gold. The tiny bottle was little larger than a thimble, and only half full. But what a treasure! The nib was rusty, easily 20 to 25 years old.
I nursed this tiny amount of ink along for several years, using it mainly on jam covers. This allowed for very, very delicate lines. You can see that in the outlines of the dolmen and the fine branches of bushes and grasses around the boulders. I let the India ink dry and added very gentle color hues by watercolor. That's how these small round things were created.
How did Ernst get so many marmalade lids? He was quite popular with the Turkish inmates, to the astonishment of some of the more vindictive Mannheim prison administration officials. Since he had such a virulent reputation as a white supremacist, the reasoning must have been that Ernst and the Turks would get in each other's hair in no time. So someone set him up for mischief. He was made to share a cell with a 300-pound Turk with a violent reputation who had allegedly tried to murder his wife.
His name was Kalib. Kalib was considered a fellow with a temper, but he was really a very pious man, who knelt 5 times a day on his prayer carpet, and not before washing his feet. Needless to say, Kalib and I got along swimmingly, since I immediately asked our Protestant pastor for a Turkish-German dictionary, so my cellmate and I could together study his Koran. Anything to pass the time, right? We sat side by side on Kalib's lower bunk bed, amicably flipping through my dictionary, reading Kalib's Koran, to the astonishment of some warden or other who had arranged for this entrapment, and who dropped by once in a while to check if this setup worked.
But Kalib became very attached to Ernst, and when he realized that he was collecting jam lids, Kalib went to his Turkish network in the prison, and in exchange for some lovely roses, Valentine's Day greeting cards, etc., they collected these little lids for Ernst, by the hundreds. In the latter years of Ernst's imprisonment, the authorities relented a bit and allowed him school children's watercolors. Then the prison allowed him to attend art classes where he could work with good quality art paper, even at the end with professional brushes obtained from an outside art supply store. One brush worth $30 or more, which vastly improved the quality of Ernst's paintings. All were paid for with money donated by friends and family on the outside. Ernst was permitted to paint on wood, cardboard, and even canvas. A number of larger canvases and paintings, mainly landscapes, were made possible due to this privilege. He was even able to use acrylic paint. Thus, the prison art made after 2007-2008 is far more professional than the sketches made before those years, with mere ballpoint pens, hard pencils, or colored crayons. He painted some works for periodic prisoners' art exhibitions. This artwork was displayed during open house, even sold when the staff's families and the doctors and nurses of the prison sick bay would tour the exhibition. He did wet-on-wet watercolors, large format, on good paper, on topics given to him by the lady art teacher, such as forests in the fog, in the fall, roses, sunflowers, poppy fields, mountain ranges. The best of these were framed and put up as wall decorations in prison meeting rooms and classrooms. They were displayed there for 3 to 4 months and then given back to Ernst on his release.
Europe is evolving, and if present trends continue, the time for some overt changes rather than changes by nuances will arrive maybe sooner than we think. Things may quickly take on a life of their own. With some luck, you and I will see amazing changes. Hard times, to be sure, but then the Western world has gone soft in body and mind for too long as it is. They need a reality check badly. Fate will whip them into shape. Remember when the Berlin Wall came down in 1989, as if by magic, and large parts of Germany were united? I'm convinced we Westerners will reunite, circle the wagons, and protect what is ours, a culture and a way of life built and refined over eons of time. Our ancestors are calling their descendants to the front. Our people have to take the bull by the horns and put their money, their talents, and their energies behind regenerative projects. Bankers do not give mortgages to right-wing think tanks. Much research to rescue our race has already been done. It awaits popularization and wide dissemination. I know exactly how we might change things if we can mobilize enough of our folk, forget our petty difference, put our shoulders to the common wheel, or throw the rudder around after we have first seized it from our enemies. What stands between us and a better, brighter, saner, healthier future is the question. Can we muster the political will to forge the necessary tools and instruments to assure our survival? I say we will. I count on our will to live. We Westerners must warn against the temptation to work over familiar ground, to split hairs and argue points already argued to exhaustion for decades. Read, and you shall find. That's why I preach with an almost religious fervor to step back, to take stock, make inventory of what is useful and worth preserving, and what can be safely turfed out. Arminius the Liberator learned his skills and his trade in the military academies and training camps of the Roman Empire 2,000 years ago. To me, that is the full story of symbolism and also a reminder of self-sacrifice and a renewed commitment to freedom. We must organize. All achievement is ultimately the victory of organization over disorganization. We must create institutions that will produce a leadership elite chosen from the rich fount of our common people. Self-liberation will not be painless, but I do not believe our beloved old continent will play second fiddle forever, and then my North American experience, gathered over half a century, of hands-on leadership will come in handy. The Spartan and Prussian ideals will once again have to suffuse all our actions and our thinking. No self-deception will succeed. Only if we, the responsible leaders, can impress upon our people the need to radically change and improve, the need to steel ourselves physically and mentally, only then can we really dream about our campaign of reconquest of our own Lebensraum. Only when we change our habits, not only what we eat and drink, but what food we take in for the soul with our eyes, ears, and minds, will we regain our freedom. Words alone, spoken or written, will not achieve it by themselves. Power goes to him who seeks it. The will to power, the will to survive, is all that is needed. We must seek the power we need. I don't call the beating up of a bunch of Middle East tin pot dictators capturing their wells and stealing their oil will to power. That's just old ordinary highway gangsterism and robbery. It ought to be really beneath us to engage in such low-life behavior. Personal sacrifice, suffering, sweat, blood, and lots of tears, along with fiscal and sexual self-control, reining in our emotions, being steady at the helm of our lives, that's how we will bring forth the heroes necessary for the enormously difficult but historically necessary task of liberating ourselves from alien interference. There will be no instant solution. There is no magic bullet, no shortcuts to victory, not in such an epic struggle to save the remnants of a great and ancient race.
There is a world to be conquered together or to be lost alone. We ask for your support. We are not interested in drawing to ourselves great numbers of lethargic people. We are interested in people of substance who are willing to act, not just to complain. There is work to be done. There are friends and supporters to be found. we invite the true Spartans of the spirit to join us.